can stop the rain. Welcome to Decent Life. I'm Lou Pulifido. The call-in number is 212-245-7273, 212-245-7273. The guidelines for calling in is to lower the volume on your computer or TV, because while you're calling in, we do not want any feedback. Also, listen to the phone and not the show, because we are on an 8-second delay, which means before you know it, I'll be hanging up and you'll be calling back. And finally, if you like, you can give us your location and your first name would be great. So always interested to know where you're watching from. And as you see today, we do have a guest, and her name is Bunny Yan, and I hope I pronounced that okay.
Yeah.
I know I got the bunny part right.
Yan's great. Yan's, yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And we're going to talk about what's sustainability in the fashion industry today. And before we go into a little bio of Bunny, just want to inform everyone that she's been a hot topic around here. Well, I would say, look, Forbes, you've been in Forbes magazine,
yes,
discussing your business, right? What you want to do. And also just recently in Echo Chic, right? And Tech Asia a couple of years ago. So this is, you're on, I guess, on the forefront of a growing industry, sustainability within the fashion industry.
Yeah, we try to stay relevant.
Okay, so basically, let's just go in and just introduce you about what's the name of your company, what's the purpose, and how did you get started, and so on.
So, hi everybody. My name is Bunny. I am the CEO of The Squirrels, and first, let me just be clear. It's called Squirrels because we gather. And what we're focusing on is how to unwaste fashion material. So our main focus at the moment is how to console brands and turn their production or marketing waste into products they can retail, exciting new marketing campaign, or feed it back into supply chain.
Okay, so What is your background in the industry here? Did you start as a buyer or a designer? Or
designer. So went to FIT, and I've been in this industry, in the fashion field and marketing for over 18 years. So a long time.
Yeah, well, that's how you learn the nuts and bolts of everything.
Yeah.
So where was it that you got this idea of, because I was kind of, you know, I say, wow, how come people weren't doing this before? Recycling fashion material, as you say, unwasting fashion material. So how did you come about with that idea, and where were you at the time?
So fashion industry is very wasteful. Everybody know about it, but when you're in the industry, you see a whole different side. You see the manufacturer side if you're into the whole QC and the production part. So for me, it was when I went to China and visited the factory, when you see just how much wastage there is. And for most people, when you hear the term wastage, it's like unclean or severely defective. That's not the case. So I bought some show and tell. Example, what you see here is a doctor scrub, right? So completely new. You can't see any defect.
That looks great.
It's beautiful and it's high quality. The problem is they were dyed a slightly too dark than what the client ordered.
Right.
So this entire batch will be discarded because it's not to the specific specs of what the client wants. And understood, if I want to sell sky blue and you give me aqua blue, I, as a retailer, I cannot sell it. But all of these are perfectly fine garments. So the day I discovered these, the whole idea behind it was, all right, so you're going to discard these beautiful garments, and why don't you sell it to me cheaper and I can make something out of.
Right.
When you start as a new brand, new design, budgeting is very important. So,
well, if you like to hoard, I guess too.
Oh, of course, if you can, you want to just get it.
Okay, but yeah. Okay, so basically, you went to China and you seen fully finished products that were just slightly irregular per se, and they were just being sent there to be burnt, burned, scrapped,
shredded into stuffings. Just does not equal to the value of a beautifully made garment.
Okay. And I know you have more to show, but does that lead into your store that you had and so on?
That shows okay, what okay. it is. Yeah. So this is what happened. Made it into the bag. It's for a full shirt.
Okay. So you took that scrub and made it into a bag.
Yeah.
Okay. I would have just bought the scrub the way it was too.
The whole idea of upcycling is very interesting. So recycling, it's paper to paper, plastic to plastic. It's make the material back into its original form. Upcycling is you look at all the characteristics of the material that you are working with and find what kind of characteristics of new products that it can match up with. So with the Dr. Scrub, it's colorful. It's machine washable, it's foldable, and this particular style have like lycra on the side, so stretchy. So it's perfect for a giant tote bag that you can stuff everything in. Yeah. So this is the beginning of the squirrel.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So yeah. Because I read that you had a brick and mortar store. Was that in Shanghai or?
It was in Shanghai. The whole idea of that is, okay, I am doing products like these, and who else is doing products like these? And you discover there are so many different brands and designers already have the whole mindset of doing things upcycle, recycle methods. It's not only because, oh, it's just so much more sustainable, because it's interesting, it's beautiful. You can create new material or create new methods to duplicate that same effect. So example, you see the clutch here.
Look at that.
Isn't that cute, clutch?
Yeah.
This is made from misprinted packagings or test print packagings. So all of these are different kind of candy.
Yeah, I was noticing.
This is from Mexico. Yeah.
From Mexico.
Uh-huh.
The
product's from Mexico.
And then you put it.
It was in my shop.
Okay, great.
So from food packaging, these are already coated. And yes, they're very hard to recycle. But making into a bag, that means like the surface area does not get scraped very easily. Right. And the color facet.
And plus, you know, when you're starting with unwanted items, you're basically saving on a lot of resources from the earth, water, energy, and so on like that. So what was interesting, so how did you make the jump from being in your store to getting online, have this app, getting noticed by everyone? Was there like a startup contest or things like that?
So as I have my shop and you collecting more and more designers who have the same passion, and what you see is there can be something more than that, because there will always be more waste as long as there's production.
Yeah, and mistakes.
Of course.
Yeah.
So I can see the potential of more designers are able to learn about just how much material that pretty much match up of what they want for their production without altering their style, altering what they want to do. There's no compromise needed. So, and there's like a China Accelerator. That's the one I joined in, pitched the idea, and they like it, and how to link the material from brands or manufacturer to designers who can remake these or make into something more useful for both ends.
Yeah. So when you were in China, they had this China Accelerator to see what startup companies that they could invest in. So you basically got an investment from China from that?
Yes.
Okay. Uh-huh. And what I read too is that, you know, I think China does about 50% of all the, I guess, clothing and fashion in globally. So.
Yeah.
Good place to start with, because they would
we
have
make
a lot
everything.
Of waste. Yeah, make everything. I guess
I'm made in China, so.
Well,
sorry. Did
okay.
I?
No. But you know what? I was just gonna say there's some good things that come from China. And what I'm trying to get at is that Do companies ship their waste there as well? To be, it's not just that they're manufacturing there, but it has become a hub for the waste as well.
So, example for plastic industry, U.S. does ship recycled plastic to China to produce.
Yeah, I got you. So, how did you get your? Oh wait, before I jump to how you got the foot in the door, I want to know how you got to see President Obama. How did that lead into? Because I thought that had to be quite a thrill.
That was very fun. So we won the China region competition of 1776 Global Challenge Cup, and that was in D.C. Mm-hmm. So because we were on their list, in D.C.'s like, White House office, we're searching for all the top innovation in different startups globally. They sent me an email, and when I first got that email saying you're invited to White House for the entrepreneur forum, I'm like, yeah, okay, email from White House. Nigerian Prince, White House. You know, I'm like, sure, delete, right? And it's not only till like the second email came through, they like, we need to do the security check. I'm like, so you don't want money from me?
Yeah, exactly. Ooh. And that must have been, did you almost pass out or what?
I called 1776, like emailed, and just make sure that, okay, you guys aware of that's actually happening. Not until the day that I'm standing in the line going into the White House, I'm like, okay, I guess it's not a scam.
Yeah. So did he give any parts or any words of wisdom?
Yeah, very articulate president.
Yeah, he is very,
Was very inspirational. We all get to network, all of us, and of course, all of us trying to stand in front of the president, like, notice me.
No, so that the 1776 thing was sponsored just by the U.S. That, or was it a global contest?
They did a global startup contest. So there's like from a bunch of different countries. Of course, there's one in U.S. And so we won the one they held in Beijing, in the capital.
Okay. Hmm. And it's a 212-245-7273. If you'd like to ask Bunny a question about, you know, how she got started or where can you find your products? But basically, we're going to lead into that.
So I don't make any products, just so you know.
you're a matchmaker.
We'll get into that.
You're a facilitator.
I'm the cog in the middle.
Okay. So how did you get your foot in the door with the major companies? Because I see on your website that you have a list of corporations.
Yeah. So the part that I got into, it's really niche. As in, everybody understand there's like waste problem or sustainability needs, but the knowledge of understanding how to upcycle something, it takes, research, experience, takes a while.
I was just interested on the name, because I looked at material upcycles.
Upcycle? Specialist? Yeah, there's nowhere. So I really looking at the value of what it can bring to brands. The hardest thing about being a big brand like fast fashion and all the global brands is that you have all of these waste, and just working with small designers, it's not going to be fast enough, nor is it going to bring much value to the brand itself. Mm-hmm. So we were trying to see how that can be solved into a win-win situation. So I got something. So this is a project we work with Ann Taylor.
All right. So
it's a cute clutch.
And this is from just there?
These are from their post-event banners from the shops.
From the banners?
Yeah. So these are the sales signs, and inside you can actually see models, right?
Yeah.
So they're already trying their environmental efforts. All their banners are made from 40% recycled plastic, which is great. But at the end, they will still end up in the landfill. And these are material that you worked on to be more eco and more green. Now let's make it the second circle, the more circular way of production, is figure out what else can you use it as. Right. So us being the cog, we link the designer who got the talent with the brands who got the need.
Okay. Mm. Yeah, basically, you're a facilitator or matchmaker between designers. As I noticed on your website, it's for brands, for designers, and for
win-win-win situations consumers, for everybody.
Right. Okay, for the brands, the bottom line is that it's more cost efficient to use stuff that's already produced, and why produce waste that's going into landfills and makes
because of that turn the material situation. Yeah, that turned the material cost for the next batch to zero and turned the carbon footprint to negative because it's already used once.
Okay. Yeah. So you're getting, and unfortunately, I should ask you up front, but what's basically the nuts and bolts of what you do? Because you were getting into, you were the cog, you're the middle person between the waste and the...
That's a nuts and bolts of what I do. So we talk to a brand and find out either their immediate needs or in their supply chain or a marketing strategy, what kind of waste they're a bundle of, and inconsistency, because those are the easiest ones to reproduce over again and not just one off. And we propose plans and what we can do with them. Either you want to get rid of them right away, which is fine. But my preferred is how to turn that into a campaign that's more targeted to their demographic or a product that matches their collection.
Okay, and what we're looking at is we have a sharing economy. So you have an app that you could download from Scrolls.
So that's
for designers and for brands, or
that's more on a material sharing side. And at the moment, we kind of pull everybody from the app to Facebook again.
Okay.
Reason being is the app was created for material sharing between designers. So if I have leftover 5 meter of white denim that I'm not using anymore, why not give it to somebody else, and somebody else have box of buttons, trimmings, notions that just piling up at one point that I want to switch to something new too. So it was great try with the app, but you start seeing that I can't really see how they interact with each other, what their needs are, how do they want to improve on that transaction? Do they want to talk to each other, be more social? So it was a great try, but we pulled it off back on the Facebook so we can see the interaction better.
Okay. Do you think that the app that you have now is somehow going to be scaled into actual industries, like Ann Taylor will have it on her desk, on their desks, and so on, to start sharing this, who has what?
But there's so many tricky parts in the middle you need to work out. So there's branding issues, there's logistics issues, how do you divide the entire batch, globalization, because a lot of material is not here. So yeah, we're still continue trying to find a better solution to fill that goal.
Right.
But at the moment, we're in the more learning stage and talking to brands, finding out what are really the pinpoint for each of them, how to provide a better solution that can get us eventually to the very sustainable circular model for entire fashion industry.
Mm-hmm.
And that works for them, works for everybody, works for us.
Yeah. So was it at one point, I've seen in an article about that you were a little, concerned about you were getting jobbers or high import export people. I'm not sure how that was working out, and that didn't fit your matter. What exactly was going on at that
point? So when we first started, was dealing with the manufacturers in China because everything was produced there.
Right.
Oh, still is. But those are bulk material. We finding 10 containers of fabrics, 500,000 shirts. It's just ridiculous amount. And the people who are interested is to resell it, which I understand, but there's no creativity there. There is an added value there. It's you buying something and you flipping it. And the person you're dealing with are traders. And that's not what I want. That's not why I started this. So as we continue to develop our business, and all the signs telling us the decision maker of how to make more value out of that is the brand itself, not their manufacturer. Mm. So we come back to New York and continue our business starting from last year. And that's since then we've been working with all the brands and able to bring them much more value than what the manufacturer do, which is just want to get rid of it as fast as you can.
And you're also working, see, well, I'm not sure because I'm not familiar with the business, brands to be including designers, or are you taking brand stuff and matching a designer that wants these?
I'm working with brands.
Just brands and within their system of, within their own company, trying to how to produce other products?
Both. Okay. It could be working with their designers or working with my community designers. So again, I'm the cog in the middle.
But my customer
focus are the brands.
I gotcha. Because that's where most of the...
That's where the problem is.
Yeah, that's where the issue is. Mm-hmm. And you're in there trying to match things up and how to get things going the right way, which is good because I think what I've seen is that some companies, some brands are trying to get people to think about recycling their clothes. Usually what I do is I don't have clothes. I go to the local, church or something, drop them off for the homeless and stuff. But there's a bigger drive to try to get people to think about recycling on that part too. But that's not really, that's a different niche.
Creating things bring any kind of community more life and more profit than just donation. So because when you donate to an area, you kind of not giving the opportunity for them to think about how they can recreate and how they can buy locally. Because if you're already getting it for free, you kill the small business who's trying to start. Yeah. It will actually backfire.
Mm-hmm.
So with upcycling, you still need to make it into something else. There's work to be done on it. And then you can add value, think of how to promote, how to sell, how to create more like that. And you inspire the community instead of just give a handout.
Exactly. And I think it's a great idea. Where do you see yourself like 5 years from now? I know everybody has these short-term and long-range plans.
Ruling the world.
So where would you like to be in 5 years from now?
I would like to be responsible for getting rid of at least 1% of the fashion waste, preventing that from the landfill. In 5 years.
And out of the billions of, I don't know if you want to say yards of waste, is that, 1%?
Oh, we produce so much material waste in the fashion industry that within the year, it can cover up the entire Manhattan Island to the top.
Okay. So how much of you are recycling now? Turning into new stuff?
So far, over 2 tons.
All right.
So still that's not good. Big. It sounds good, but it's not big enough. But we are rolling and we're starting, and it's hard to measure how much the people you inspire saved. That's like how much I can track that I able to measure how much, was in the community that I shared. I want to inspire more and they can do more and to the point that I can't track anymore, but it's all credit to me.
Okay, so basically in 5 years, we hope that just squirrels will do 1%, and hopefully there were other
or
companies
inspire.
That come inspire other people to come along and say, look, we can change the world. And that's what this is what this show is all about. Decent Life is to show people examples that, people can change the world and have different outlooks in life and say, hey, you know what? This sounds so simple. How come nobody did it before? And like I said, your concept is
thank you. Yeah, I don't want to do that whole guilt trip thing. Of course, we are saying like you should buy less and really watch your consumption. Sure,
that's great. Yeah.
But at the end, you want to buy stuff that you like, and you want to dress the way you like, feel the way you like, and I want to enable that.
Yeah, exactly.
And just in a better way, in a more efficient way. It's not just about sustainability or eco, but just good business. Okay. It saves you money on the long run as well, and the short term, and you produce products that are exciting with a story and beautiful.
If people want, are inspired, they want to contact you, just go to the squirrels.com
and just email me.
Website, email you, and hopefully from this show you'll get tons of emails, and hopefully none of them from Nigeria.
We encourage everybody, if you are from Nigeria and you want to email me, that's okay too.
Like I was saying, this show's about inspiration, new ideas of how to get things going. And with your idea and people like you out there, we can stop the rain. And all we need is love. Bunny, thank you for being on the show.
Thank you.
I really enjoy this. And hopefully, maybe in about a year or so, you can come back and talk about how things are going.
Oh, that would be great.
And thanks for watching, everybody.
Bye.